I'm a person asking to tell a story, so at least some of you know who I am. I got stories I can tell forever and ever and ever. Seen a lot of things, been a lot of places. And I like telling stories. Some of them aren't relevant. But I got a story for about everything, you know, that you want to hear. However, I'm going to tell you a story that happened 18 years ago. And this morning was the first time I told the story. So I should get an honorary doctorate degree because I spent like 2 days with three of these guys and I like got brain overload, but I finally come to the conclusion of what actually went on here. But so anyway, I'm gonna tell a story that this is only the second time I've told in 18 years. And so that in itself is something I needed to understand of why it took me this long to tell a story. And I figured it out. So I guess the point to you is don't wait 18 years to tell a story. Tell a story, make it relevant, have it facilitated, learn from it, and then you won't have to wait 18 years to try to figure out what happened. Okay? So I'm going to set the stage a little bit. Well, it's interesting. So in 1998, our team went to Florida. And as Mike Dudley said, 1998 was probably some of the first time Area Command really got engaged. And we went under Area Command, under E.G. Rhodes Williams, Area Command. Our team was assigned the Orlando Complex. And the Orlando Complex consisted of four counties. Brevard County, Seminole County, Osceola County, and Orange County. And if you know anything about Florida, those counties ought to ring some bells, like Disney World, Cocoa Beach, Florida, Daytona, Kennedy Space Center, Cape Canaveral, Space Shuttle Landing, all those kind of things. Most of those, other than Walt Disney World, is in Brevard County on the coast. So lots of people, lots of infrastructure, lots of things going on there. And so we were in Unified Command of Florida, DOF. However, at the bottom, we are not in Unified Command with Structured Protection or County Fire. So now you have to remember in 1998, Florida was some of the first urban interface that we really got engaged in wildland fire in a big picture. So automatically, it's a square peg in a round hole for us because there's just lots of people there. Sometimes where we come from, nowadays, there's a lot of people and things we do there. In 98, that many years ago, we let certain people handle certain things, but this is one of the first times that wildland fire was actually asked to do things that we really didn't know much about. So the other thing that was, if you think back in 1998, how many of you in 1998, 18 years ago, had a cell phone? Yeah, one. Okay. Well, I got one, but you have to go back there because now. So I was given a cell phone, and I also didn't have a radio to talk to the chief. Money's over in Brevard County, so as a Type 1 Ops chief, I specifically had Brevard County. Okay, and some of the Ops chiefs had some of the other counties. Our direction was that we were supposed to suppress every fire within those four counties. End of story. When we left there, I'll go back. Brevard County, when we left, had 532 fires in it during our stay. Just that county. If you understand Florida, they talk about sea breezes. So if you're on the Gulf Coast side, you usually get a Gulf Coast breeze that blows inland. And if you're on the Atlantic side, you get an Atlantic sea breeze that blows inland. So basically, in Florida, you have two sea breezes that blow inward. Well, in 98, there were no sea breezes. As you can tell by the smoke columns, everything was headed to the sea. There was no sea breeze blowing in. So all the infrastructure I talked about, Kennedy, Cape Canaveral, Kennedy Space Center, all the houses, homes, Cocoa Beach, Daytona, as you can see, everything was blowing right at them. different from anything they've experienced. This is day 7 of the incident. And it's the morning of July 1. You can see what the temperatures were that morning. That was the morning, not the afternoon. Our ICP is down here in Cocoa. And this is north, quite a little ways. This is I-95. It's the major corridor between north and south, between Jacksonville and the Keys. And this is actually US 1, and it's another major north-south route. When I left the night before, we had 5 fires that we were trying to work with. This little spot right here is what's called Fawn Lake Subdivision. Fawn Lake Subdivision is a retirement home for retired astronauts. Buzz Aldrin has a home there. And so that comes into play as we talk about the story. But anyway, this is kind of the scenario. The other thing I want to point out is there's a power line right here, okay? A big power line, big transmission line. And that will come into play a little bit in our story. So again, I-95, US 1, Fawn Lake Subdivision is down here just a little bit off the map. This is what's called the Hog Valley Road. This is a rest area on the interstate, big rest area. Power line again is running right here, big power line. But what you don't see in there is on-ramps to the interstate. To get over to here or anywhere in here, you have to take off of 95 here, go into Titusville, come up US 1, come across and under the interstate and around over here. So there's a little, the egress isn't quite what I would call satisfactory. So a few things I want to point out there. So this is as I seen I-95 when I was going north. This is the traffic coming south from Volusia County and Flagler counties, because they done some evacuations up there. And so this is southbound traffic, which obviously I didn't pay any attention to, because I'm going northbound. I'm going from Cocoa northbound, so southbound traffic didn't mean a whole lot to me at that time. July 1st, 7 days into the incident, we had our morning briefing at ICP, and I left ICP with all the divisions and the troops, and you know how operations are. We kind of got out of camp a little late because everything else going on. We were hoping the divisions would get out and get established, get the resources going on, and get going. So, you know, just the normal day. So here's what I thought were the mission critical events that happened as I see it. Right off the bat, I get in the vehicle and I got a Jeep Cherokee. It's really nice. It's a rental vehicle and it's pretty awesome. And so I'm headed northbound to meet up with all the resources, see what's going on. On my way up the interstate, I get a call on the radio from my counterpart with DOF. And he says, hey, we've gotten 39 new starts from the night before, and I need some resources for initial attack. So I was thinking, well, you know, we need to initial attack. We need to try to put out all the fires we can. So I call the divisions, and we cut a bunch of resources with us to go do initial attack. The next thing that happens is I'm going up the road, is I get a call from the division that says these 5 fires have grown into 1, and it's threatening the Fawn Lake Subdivision, and we've got all this aircraft flying around. And some of it is ours, and some of it we don't know where it came from. But there is no communication. The air attack calls me and said, hey, if we don't get something shut down, I'm shutting all our air resources down. So I said, okay, well, send our air resources back to hell, basically. You know, we're not going to have anything like that happen, so just shut it down. I get to Fawn Lake Subdivision, find out Buzz Aldrin has picked up the telephone and called a few of his friends, and all of a sudden there's aircraft flying all over the place. So I said, anyway, I told the division, well, this is what we'll do, just send the aviation back and just do what you can. Try to do whatever you can, and I'll try to help you out the best way I can. In the meantime, at the same time, I get another on the radio, and I found out that the dozer boss, one of the dozer bosses that was trying to find a strike team of the dozers that were headed out to the Tule Woods, when these five fires combined, got caught in the smoke, and he's on a dozer line, and he don't know which direction he's going or where he's going. He can't see, he doesn't know where he's going. And I'm really trying to scratch my head a little bit. And so I said, do you have any kind of idea what direction you're going or what bearing or anything? And he was like, no. So I asked him if he had a compass in his vehicle on the dashboard or up on that. And he actually did. He looked up and he goes, yeah, I got a compass in my vehicle. I said, so use it. And so we talked him out, was talking him out of there by direction of the compass in his vehicle. What direction are you going? North. Okay, well, you need to turn around and come south, you know. So we were, that's how we were getting him out of there. So we were working on that. I get a call from another subdivision, or another division, saying, I hate to tell you this, but fire has jumped into the power line. So this is interesting to me, because in that world, if you potato patch with tractor plows, they tell me that that'll stop the fire. So we potato patched this power line, and it's a huge power line. It's wider than this room. And so I'm feeling pretty good about it. Well, we're going to hold fire in the power line. And so I get this call. Guess what? We got fire in the power line, or maybe across. So what do I do? My ears turn and say, well, forget about the dozer bus guy. You got him coming. Forget about Fawn Lake. Now I'm tuning into what's going on to the power line. So, you know, what do you, I get in my vehicle, start heading right to the power line. The next thing that happens is, as I get there, I find that Chief Moneys has called all his counterparts from all over the counties, and I got 63 Type 1 fire ladder structure protection vehicles moving in to protect homes on top of the resources that we have. But I have to pick up another radio to talk to Chief Money while I'm talking on this radio while I'm trying to answer the cell phone and talk on the cell phone. So I really have no control of those folks, because we're not in unified command with them. So what happens is as the fire progresses, and this is a little further, a little down the road, but they pulled in to do structure protection, but the public got really smart. And they found out that if they picked up the phone and they called 911, they could get an engine over to their structure. And so what was happening is, somebody would call 911 saying, fire's going to advance on my house and I really need a fire truck over here. Chief Moneys would get on the radio and dispatch one of those trucks over to that house. And by the time that engine got to that house burnt down. And by the time they got back to the structure they were protecting, it burnt down. So I was trying to get a hold of Chief Bundy's and say, look, that's not working. We're burning every house down instead of saving at least half of them. So please just keep people in place and let's do what we can. So that was going on. Then I came to the conclusion that, man, I got a hell of a lot of traffic on the interstate. And if I don't get to shut the interstate down, I'm going to kill some people. I'm going to kill a lot of people. So I get on the phone, trying to figure out the cell phone, how it works, and making some calls and talking to Chief Moneys, and I'm like, we got to shut this interstate down, or we're going to kill some people. Is that what it is? I don't even need to hear that. So I get into this debate about whether or not I need to close the interstate down, and it's like, this isn't a debate. We got to get those people shut down. We got to get them off the interstate, because this thing's going to get smoking, and there's going to be fire coming across the interstate, and we're going to kill people. And so anyway, the message back to me was, look, sir, this is the governor, and we got Daytona tomorrow, and you're not shutting the interstate down. I'm like, well, then it's all on your shoulders if you don't shut the interstate down. Basically, they got the interstate shut down, and because what they decided to do is they could shift traffic from I-95 over to US-1. US 1 was the other north-south. But by the time they got the interstate closed down, fire was already across US 1 as well. Because we didn't have a sea breeze. So the next thing that comes to my mind in this story is, wow, now I shut the interstate down, and now I have no way to evacuate 10,000 people because I have the interstate closed. So I made a decision that caused trouble for me on my next decision. So I had to figure out a way to get 10,000 people out of Titusville and Scottsmore and Mims out on the interstate, get them evacuated because everything was happening. So we figured it out. We got them down US 1, and we actually got them out the bottom of the interstate, and we made it happen. The next thing that happened that's not on here is I got Texas Canyon and John Armstrong up in no man's land and digging a line, which in itself was, what was that all about? Because as they found out that they dug line for 3 days and got from me to Alex, and it wasn't working too well. And I get a call that a Dairy Queen just got burned down, which was close to US 1. So I was thinking, wow, this is a little bigger than I thought it was going to be. The next thing that came to my mind was, dang, I got a whole bunch of resources and I don't have a way to egress and get out of here. Because the on-ramp is, I'm actually going to have to drive through fire and around fire to get on the on-ramp to get out of the top of the interstate and get them out of there. So I knew of a little spot on the end of the Hogsback Road, because that interstate has a long chain link fence that runs up both sides. And so I told folks, if anybody comes across a pair of bolt cutters, let me know. I need to get a hold of them. And they're like, what for? I'm like, just find the bolt cutters. Well, here comes somebody with a pair of pruning shears that you prune trees with. And I took those pruning shears and I went to the end of the Hogsback Road and I took the pruning shears and I worked my butt off to cut the chain link fence out at the end of the Hogsback Road to roll the chain link fence back. To tell people that when I pull the plug, I want you to come out the Hogsback Road directly onto the interstate and go down to the rest area. Everybody knew where the rest area was. So that was the plan. That's what we were going to do, because there was no way we were going to get out of there any other way. When I pulled the plug, got everybody out of there, we went down to the rest area and we counted. And I think there was somewhere to 300 people that I had, not counting municipal structure trucks and those kind of people. But when I got down there, I counted and I was missing one. So again, you know, what do? Everybody stay put. I'm getting my nice Grand Cherokee and we'll head back in. So I go back up, go back in, into fire, and I find this individual back there with the palmetto leaf. Swatting fire, beat crazy, saving homes right and left. So he thought he was. And I said, look, buddy, let's get in, let's get out of here. And so he hopped in, and we were headed out the Hogsback Road for a second time. And on my way out, I see a small boy about 6, 7, 8 years old on his bicycle coming down the Hogsback Road, headed into the fire. And as I waved him over and asked him what he was doing, he said, my dog is in my house, and my house is going to burn, and my dog is going to burn, so I've got to go get my dog. Get my dog out of the house. And so I said, well, I didn't quite hear you. Come over here and tell me again. And he got close, and I just reached through the window and grabbed him, pulled him into the vehicle, and we went. And he came kicking and screaming and bawling and everything else. And we got out of there. And later to find out, somebody turned his dog loose, and his dog had been running around out in the town all over. He found it the next day, but we didn't know that, you know. But anyway, a couple other things that went on at that time that caused me some problems was an individual came running out of nowhere saying his house was going to burn down. There wasn't no engines there. He didn't have a way to put the fire out. He didn't have any water, because when you kill the power lines in Florida, everybody's on a well. So all the water gets shut off because the power gets shut off, so you have no well. So he has no way to fight fire. So what do? I reach in my pack and give him two fusees and tell him to go burn out from his house. Just find a place and go run out around your house, which created me more fire. But I wasn't thinking about more fire. I mean, I was thinking about, well, here, take some fusees and go be an arsonist and save your home. Another individual came to me wanting to know who burned his house down and saved his garage. And that would mean, and he said, that's good, because I got $80,000 worth of airboats in my garage, and my trailer house wasn't worth a whole lot. So thank you. That was probably the only thanks I got. So here's the Hogs Valley Road. And here's, so this is an interesting photo, and I still don't know why I took a picture of this, because of all the stuff that was going on in Florida. It's like, really? My wife's like, really? You came home with a speed limit sign and a pink flag hanging on it? You know, and a house that burnt down and a chain link fence? What's that all about? And so what happened was, we all came out of the road and we went right straight through the chain link fence and hit the interstate. I still don't know why I have that picture. I don't know why I have this picture either, but I guess this was closure for me. This was when we all got to the rest area, and we all counted heads, and we were all there, safe and sound. And I thought it was pertinent to take a picture. This is kind of where we left, thank goodness. And we were all safe and sound. However, 7 Type 1 trucks burnt to the ground in place, structural engines. 54 of those people that were with Municipal County either had heat exhaustion or heat stroke. You know, if you're around those folks when they're in full protection gear and it's 106 degrees or probably 120 by then, you can't drink enough water and wear that stuff around and fight fire. So there were some things that came out of that. So end the story. I know myself pretty well, and I know when I get stressed. When I get stressed, I get a migraine headache, and I get it instantly. I've come home from incidents, and I went to a doctor, and they said, your blood pressure is through the roof, come back in a day or two. I go back, and they go, wow, your blood pressure is fine. But I know during some incidents, and when I get home, I got to have time to unwind and get rid of the migraine headache. I had a migraine headache that day, and I told people, just stay put, I'm going to be back in a minute. So I got in my vehicle and I thought, I wonder how fast this Grand Cherokee can go up the closed interstate going the wrong direction. So I went down the interstate and changed ramps and got on the other side going northbound, and I zoomed the wrong direction on the interstate, got up to about 90 miles an hour. And I went that way for a long ways, and my headache went away, and I turned around and I came back and everything was fine. The thing I didn't do is I didn't do a very good of an AAR, because even to this day, I have people ask me why we didn't, what I was thinking by pulling people out of there. I have people say, I don't understand still to this day why you pulled us out of there. The guy that was using the palmetto leaf, swatting fire, he's like, I was doing great. Why did you come get me? And so I had to AAR my own self. And what I came out of this is, and I won't use that term, what I came out of this is I made one really bad decision. A really bad decision. Anybody know what that was? No, that was a great decision. In my after action, what's that? Who said? What I came to the conclusion was is that I was pretty strong for a while, and I took a lot of hits, and I stood standing, right? And then I got knocked down a whole lot, and I got back up. But what didn't I do at the end? And I ended up getting out of the way. But what I came to the conclusion was that my situational awareness wasn't really well. It wasn't very good, because if I would have identified that I lost half my resources first thing in the morning, I probably should have thought about another plan. And then when I lost my aviation, I probably should have come up with another plan. And when all things were going wrong, I just really didn't take time to think about anything other than what I was focused on. And what I was focused on is I'd made a relationship with a lot of people there in those 7 days. And I made a commitment to them that I would stay there, come hell or high water, and I would save every home, and I was going to put the fire out, and they didn't need to worry about it. And I had all the resources in the world. And don't worry about it. My name's Rowdy, and I'll stand here till the end of the world, and I'll save you and protect you. And I throw this out because I think there's another thing we need to understand. When you're on your home turf and you get to know people and you know them personally, you do things differently. You do things differently than you do away from those kind of people that you don't know. We know that in emergency management situations where you respond to an accident and you know the person in the accident, you do things totally different than you do if it's someone you don't know. So what happened here is that commitment to put every fire out, the direction from the agency administrator or from area command that says suppress every fire, and my commitment and my integrity, my responsibility to save every home and everything, I guess was a prideful thing for me, is how I would put it. I felt like my pride didn't allow me to disengage. So as I thought about this, what would have happened if I would have recognized all these things earlier and I just would have said, hey, let's just go to the rest area. Let's think this thing over before we do any kind of engagement. Sure would have saved me about 17 emergents that I wouldn't have had to deal with. I could have only dealt with one. So the take-home message for you folks, I guess, is don't wait 18 years to tell a story that might make sense to you, because after this morning, this thing makes perfect sense to me. I now realize what all came down, and I got a better understanding and picture of where I was personally and what was going on. But you know what it took till this morning to understand what happened to me individually and what happened to those folks. And you know, to this day, I can't go to them and tell them that was the best decision we made, because they still look at me going, I still don't get that, Dave, why you pulled us out of there. So it makes me wonder. So with that, that's pretty much my story.